Today is the day of a very busy season. As you can see from the insert in your bulletin, today we will dedicate the Bob Curvers Memorial Library. There is coffee and tea and space for fellowship in the annex, which is just the main room, which is just off of the library, which is the small room to your left when you walk into the door. I encourage you to come and enjoy some time of fellowship and also to check out this new library that was graciously donated by Kate Curvers in honor of her husband, Bob Curvers. And then this afternoon, there are those from this congregation who will be walking in the crop walk. If you were not able to sign up to walk for the crop walk, but would like to support one of our walkers, I know that they've been running around in the narthex trying to get more donations. So if you would like to donate to one of our walkers, I know that Janet Droz is walking, that Priscilla and Linda are walking, that Kelly Larson is walking, that Jonna and Larry are walking. I am walking. Did I miss anyone? Oh, and Kathy Odinsky is also walking. So if you would like to support one of us in this fight against world hunger, I encourage you to find one of us following the worship service this morning. Next Sunday, following worship, we will be meeting as a group down in the Christian Education Building for our kickoff for our stewardship campaign this year for the upcoming budget of 2022. All of the committees that are part of this congregation will have a display booth, a table set up that will explain what they do, who they are, the funding they need to continue the programs that they have going on, as well as new ones that they would like to start next year, as well as sign-up sheets for those who would like to serve on that committee. Refreshments will be served, so I encourage you to take just a few moments following the worship service to gather in the Christian Education Building next Sunday. On October 31st, the Fellowship in Growth will once again be hosting our neighborhood trunk or treat. If you would like to be part of that and decorate your trunk for the neighborhood children who will be coming through for trick or treat on that afternoon, I encourage you to sign up in the narthex. And of course, last but not least, on November 7th, we will be having our first ever, since I've been here at least, variety show that is being organized by Jim Smith. Mark it on your calendars. From 2 to 4 in the afternoon, we will be enjoying talents from those here in this congregation. Please now take a few moments to greet those who joined you for worship. Before we move into our call to worship, there's one other announcement. As you may have seen on your Friday forget-me-nots that were sent out religiously every week by our wonderful admin, Dawn, we have an excess of cardboard from the stand, the TV, the mugs, all of the things that we accumulated for our 150th anniversary celebration. So if you would be able to and have room in your recycling bin at home, if you could take some of the cardboard with you this morning, that would be really helpful. We do not have recycling here at the church because for businesses and organizations, they actually charge for it. So we do not have that here at the church, so we're asking for your help so that we can be more conscientious in taking care of all of that cardboard.
By whatever name we call God, God is there.
God is listening and speaking into our silence.
God is waiting and ready during our shouting.
God is
Thank you.
join me in the prayer of invocation. Holy dwelling place, your tent is wide enough to provide shelter for all who seek you, food for all who hunger, and healing for all who suffer. Meet us here today and fill us with confidence in your presence, that we may risk becoming a place of love and justice you desire for all. Teach us how we may best serve ourselves and one another on this daring adventure. Amen. All right, the first reading today is from Job chapter 38, verses 1 through 7 and 34 through 41. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind, "Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up your loins like a man. I will question you, and you shall declare to me. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me, if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? Or what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone? When the morning stars sang together and all the heavenly beings shouted for joy, can you lift up your voice to the clouds so that a flood of waters may cover you? Can you send forth lightning so that they may go and say to you, here we are? Who has put wisdom in the inwards parts or given understanding to the mind? Who has the wisdom to number the clouds? Or who can tilt the waterskins of the heavens? When the dust runs into a mass and the clods cling together, can you hunt the prey for the lion or satisfy the appetite of the young lions when they crouch in their dens or lie in wait for their covert? Who provides for the raven its prey when its young ones cry to God and wander about for lack of food?" Our second reading is Psalm 91, 9 through 16. "Because you have made the Lord your refuge, the Most High your dwelling place, no evil shall befall you, no scourge come near your tent. For he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the adder, the young lion and the serpent you will trample underfoot. Those who love me I will deliver. I will protect those who know my name. When they call to me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them. With long life, I will satisfy them and show them my salvation." And last but not least is Mark chapter 10, verses 35 through 44. "James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to Jesus and said to him, 'Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you.' And he said to them, 'What is it you want me to do for you?' And they said to him, 'Grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left in your glory.' But Jesus said to them, 'You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?' They replied, 'We are able.' Then Jesus said to them, 'The cup that I drink you will drink, and with the baptism with which I am baptized you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared.' When the ten heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, 'You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. But whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave of all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many.'"
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jim, for gifting us and blessing us with your talents this morning. I also wish to lift up Jackie, who is graciously playing the organ for us more often than not. And we thank you very much for your service to the church. Yes. Let us pray. Oh God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight this morning. Amen. The plot is simple. In the biblical myth of Job, there was a pious man named Job. He was very prosperous and he had a large family, 7 sons and 3 daughters. Many would say that he led a charmed life. God asks Satan, literally the adversary, his opinion of this man, Job. And Satan answers that Job is pious only because God has put a wall around him, protecting him from misfortune and blessing him with prosperity. If God were to take away Job's possessions and wealth, Satan is betting that Job would curse God. Taking up the wager, God gives Satan permission to test Job's righteousness. There follows a string of horrible events. All of Job's possessions are destroyed, and then a ruha, wind or spirit, causes a house to collapse, killing Job's beloved children. Yet despite everything, Job doesn't curse God, but says stoically, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." Now, not convinced of Job's sincerity, Satan takes things up a notch, actually afflicting Job's body. Now that he's in utter misery, Mrs. Job advises him to curse God and die. And still, Job remains steadfast in his devotion to God. Now, a number of years ago, Professor Bart Ehrman published a book titled God's Problem: How the Bible Fails to Answer Our Most Important Question, Why We Suffer. He looked at the book of Job as a primitive attempt to explain suffering and found it to be sadly lacking in answers. But is the point of the book of Job really to explain or answer the question, why do people suffer? If that's the point of this biblical myth, then I must agree that the story fails to answer the question. Why does poor Job suffer? The explanation for the cause of Job's suffering is almost comical in the opening chapter. God and Satan get into an argument over whether Job really loves God. So God says to Satan, "Go ahead and work your evil on innocent Job, and let's just see what happens." Now, this makes God out to be capricious and fickle and almost sadistic in this weighty wager that denotes Job as a mere pawn in the plot of this story. Why is Job in misery? Essentially, why is there suffering? The answer is basically because bad stuff just happens. End of explanation, which is hardly an explanation at all. So why is there human suffering? Well, I believe that we are created as animals rather than as divine beings. Human beings are born in pain. As we grow up, we have good days and we have bad days. Sometimes we suffer, and sometimes we live long lives, and sometimes we live short lives. That's what animals do. And while we're amazing animals, we are still fragile, vulnerable, and limited. Now, that's not an injustice. It's just basic biology. A woman suffering through a difficult illness said to her doctor, "I just can't figure out what I've done to deserve this sort of pain." And her doctor responded, "What have you done? Well, in the first place, you were born. And this hospital has 600 beds, and in every bed is a person who got born. I hate to tell you, but in your pain right now, you are nobody special. You're not alone. Just one more person who got born and who right now, having enjoyed the fun of being a living person, now endures the pain of being a living person." You can almost hear the mic drop. This being our reality as finite beings, then let me say again, maybe, just maybe, explanation is not really the point of the book of Job in the first place. By the time that the book of Job ends, after Job has cried out, "Can you hear me now, God?" to an unresponsive God, he receives not a satisfying, intellectually sensible explanation for his pain and his suffering. Instead, he receives God. At the end of the story, Job receives God in all God's majestic, prickly otherness and love. A Belgian priest, Joseph Damien, was sent in 1873 to minister to the lepers in Hawaii. As soon as he arrived on Molokai, he began trying to build relationships with the residents of this leper colony, but they rejected him. He poured himself into his ministry, building a small chapel and holding worship services, but hardly anyone came. After 12 long years, he gave up. While standing on the pier, about to board the ship that would take him back to Belgium, he looked down at his hands. The white spots that he saw could only mean one thing. He had contracted leprosy. So instead of going home, he returned to his work at the leper colony. Now, the news of the priest's disease spread through the community within hours, and soon the lepers, hundreds of them, had gathered outside his home. They understood his pain and his despair. And the following Sunday, when Damien arrived at the chapel, the small building was filled to overflowing. And that was the beginning of a long and deep relationship of mutuality and love. And what made the difference? The islanders knew that he finally understood their condition, that he actually heard their despair and distress. There was no question about whether he cared or not. There was no question now about whether he heard them. In the same way, we have a God, being itself, who can hear us now, whether in the thunder and the lightning or in the still small voice or in our joys and sorrows. As the writer of Psalms sang, "When they call to me, I will listen. I will be with them in trouble." Being itself, blows in and speaks through a tempest to Job, reaches out to Job, and ultimately blesses Job with presence. Now we come away from this story not with satisfying answers to big questions, but with something better. God, who is grander than the gods of our own design, who in love gave our lives a beginning and shall in love also be there at the end. And through it all, in sickness and in health, in joy and in sorrow, God can hear us now. Amen. Before our time of communion and conversation with our God, the God who is present and who is being itself, I lift up those from this congregation who are in need of our continued prayers. And so I lift up those who continue their recovery, Cinda and Brad, and blessings to Yvonne Anderson, who was released this week and is back at Seasons and can be reached at the number that is published in your directory. If you wish to call, you also may send cards to Yvonne. I also lift up Beverly. Beverly Kirkpatrick will be having surgery this week on her foot, and I ask that you hold her in your prayers for a successful surgery and a speedy recovery. Let us pray. Great love, it is human nature to wrestle with those great, perplexing questions of life and living. And yet sometimes the answer to those questions is there is no sufficient answer except for you. Your love, your presence, your support, your compassion. That truly is the answer to those questions that have no answer. It is you. Your presence, being itself, with us from the day we are born until the day we leave this earth. Remind us that it is relationship. Your presence and an active and engaged relationship with you that is really what matters. Today, great love, we lift up those from this congregation who truly are in need of your continued strength and presence. And so we lift up Yvonne and Cinda and Brad, asking that you continue to be with them in their healing process. We also lift up Beverly, as well as the doctors and the nurses that will tend to her this week as she undergoes surgery. And now, O God, hear our private, our personal joys and concerns raised to you. We lift all of these prayers to you in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our stewardship campaign for 2022. You will be hearing from a number of our members in the next couple of weeks about what this church means to them and why they continue to support it with their time and their treasure and their talents.
Good morning. My name is Jay Wendell Kirkpatrick. And in order to tell you what this church means to me, I kind of got to take you back to a time before I found the church. The year was 1995, and our family had just lost my older brother at the age of 28 years old. And I, in fact, was the last person to see him alive, and the last thing I said to him was a lie. I told him I would be back to check on him later. I knew he wasn't feeling well. But at this point in my life, it was a pretty low time, and I was actively involved in my alcoholism, and I thought it'd be better to go to the bar and get drunk. And I found out the next day he had passed away, and just like Satan was saying in Job there, I raised my fist to God and cursed him and hated God pretty badly at that point. I'm sorry. I fell into an even deeper level of alcoholism. Went from an occasional once in a day drinker to an all the time, every single moment I was awake, I was drinking. My dad, John, shortly after my brother had passed, actually experienced a white light moment where he saw the clouds part, saw my brother's face, and my brother told him and spoke to him and said that he was all right. And I was very impressed by this because that was something I was looking for. And I did not know how to find it. Shortly after that, we started going around Reno and visiting all the different Christian churches and Baptist churches, trying to find one that we could fit into. I had visited this church on the at the AA meeting here, and I was impressed by the building and the structure. And I suggested to my dad that we ought to look into this one. And he said, Congregationalism? I don't know. And so we came by to check it out anyway, and we were immediately impressed with Reverend Bill Crystal and the way he broke down the scriptures and explained it, and my dad was extremely impressed as well, which is no small feat. And we became members of the church. And shortly after that, I was still dealing with my grief and my alcoholism, and I thought maybe I could do the confirmation thing and get baptized in the Christian faith, and I asked Reverend Crystal to take me down to the river the way John the Baptist did it. And he did, and he dunked me in there, and it was freezing cold in April, which was a great time to do it. But I can tell you at that moment when he laid hands on me in that river, an extreme sense of warmth and comfort came over me. I was not cold at all. Getting out of the river, I was not cold. I didn't need a towel. Everything was brighter, more vivid. And for me, that was my white light experience. It did not help with my alcoholism. That did take the AA program, and I became sober in January 2000. And the program tells us to, you know, embrace religion and see where the priests are correct. And I started attending church more often. It was around this time, shortly after that, that I met the love of my wife, Kate. And we got married in this church. I couldn't imagine getting married anywhere else but by this humongous cross. And Pastor or Reverend Crystal performed that service as well, which to me was just perfect. It was every kind of weather that day, and that's been amazing as well. Good old Reno. Continue to come back. Our children have grown up here, have been a part of the Christian education, the youth group, the confirmation group. All the things this church does with Rise and Dine and Our Place and the food cabinet, very active in the community, and I'm very proud of the fact that the church does that. But even more than that is the what we believe in, you know, as this congregation is something I believe in. I don't care how old you are, what you look like, what you believe in. I love you, and that's the way I think it's meant to be. Love one another, cherish one another, forgive one another. Let's all get along. And that's something this church has instilled in me, and I'm forever grateful for it. And I definitely believe in that. When I was nominated to become treasurer of the church, I thought that would be a real easy thing to do with my time, and I've been informed that it's a 3-year commitment, so it's gonna be a real easy thing to do for a long time. But I highly recommend it. There are so many different committees, so many different things this church does out there in the community. The trunk or treat coming up to help the kids, the angel tree where we help the kids, you know, some might not even have a Christmas to look forward to without the generosity of this congregation. And it's things I believe in, you know. If you have something, give it back, you know. And so that's why I found this church. That's how I've come to enjoy this church. And that's why I'm going to continue to keep coming back to this church. And now we turn you back over to your regularly scheduled programming.
Thank you, Jay. That was beautiful, to say the least. That was very moving. Thank you for sharing with us. It is not easy to come and testify before people, which is why it's not something that many people do. So when it is done, it takes a lot of courage, and we greatly appreciate it. And now let us present our gifts to God.
Please join me in the prayer of dedication. Loving God, thank you for all the gifts you have given us. Help us be grateful. Now we share our gifts. Please accept these gifts of love that we offer to enhance the lives of others. For you have taught us that what we do for the least of our brothers and sisters, we do for you. Thank you for providing us with the means, the will, and the opportunity to share your love. May our gifts be used for your mission in our church and the world. Amen.
And now may God be with you. May God's face shine upon you in your coming and in your going. May God bless you and keep you until we meet again. Amen.